we want to talk about the last words before somebody dies. I remember my father passing. I remember my mother passing. And those last few moments when perhaps they have the ability to communicate, you're really focused. What do you have to say? What do you have to say at the very end? And David has last words that we're gonna take a look at this morning. But I think our society is very interested in last words. If you go out and you do a search for celebrity last words, you'll find some very interesting things, because somebody is dutifully recording the last words of people who are famous. So I found some. And I want to talk about some of those. Dominique Bouhours, French, was a French grammarian, meaning he was all about grammar. So as he's passing away, he says, "I am about to, or I am going to die. Either expression is correct." So he spent his whole life correcting others. Wants to make sure that it is correct, whatever is being said. Those were his last words. You know, I'm getting some static, and I wonder if it's, do you think it's the batteries, Tom? No? Okay. It's brushing. It's brushing someplace. We'll try not to brush. Okay. Let's see. Aaron Burr. He's third vice president of the United States. Burr was an avowed atheist, very clearly an avowed atheist, and his last words are a response to the effort of his friend, Reverend P.J. Van Pelt, to get Burr to state that there was a God. And his response was, "On that subject, I am coy." Wouldn't state it. Would not state there was a God. If this is too distracting, I'd be happy to hold a handheld microphone as I speak. If the scratching is too distracting. Winston Churchill, as he is slipping into a coma and dies 9 days later, his last statement is, "I'm so bored with it all." Winston Churchill. Grover Cleveland, 22nd, the 24th President of the United States, says, "I have tried so hard to do right." Kind of feel for somebody like that. Here we go. But the last one is really sad. Joan Crawford, actress from the 30s and 40s, had a long career. Her housekeeper started to pray for her. And she actually had an expletive in front of this that I deleted. But it's, "Don't you dare ask God to help me." Left this world shaking her fist at God. Some of you may also be aware of others who have perhaps recorded something to be played at their funeral. I remember some of you may be familiar with Dr. Harold Burkholder, who was at Grace University, president of Grace for many years and taught there for many years. And he recorded something that he wanted played at his funeral. And it was, in essence, it was a sermon. He wanted to make sure that people understood the message, the gospel message, the message of Jesus Christ, and so he made sure that was recorded. Brenda and I recorded our parents. We recorded both sets of parents when they were in their 70s and just sat down and talked to them about their life. And then the last question was always, "So what do you want to make sure generations that follow understand? What do you want to say to them?" And so they had an opportunity to record that. Well, there were no videos during the time of King David, and so there is recorded in 2 Samuel chapter 23 his final words. And so we want to read through that passage and talk about his final words. So let's take a look at 2 Samuel chapter 23 verses 1 through 7 and read through that passage. "Now these are the last words of David." So it starts right out telling you what it is. "These are the last words of David." And they probably weren't his actual last words, but perhaps his last recorded words of David. The oracle of David, the son of Jesse, the oracle of the man who was raised on high, the anointed of the God of Jacob, the sweet psalmist of Israel. The Spirit of the Lord speaks by me, his word is on my tongue, the God of Israel has spoken. The Rock of Israel has said to me, when one rules justly over men, ruling in the fear of God, he dawns on them like the morning light, like the sun shining forth on a cloudless morning, like rain that makes grass to sprout from the earth. For does not my house stand so with God? For he has made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and secure, for he will not cause to prosper, for will he not cause to prosper all my help and my desire? But worthless men are like thorns that are thrown away, for they cannot be taken with the hand. But the man who touches them arms himself with iron and the shaft of a spear, and they are utterly consumed with fire. Well, those of you that had an opportunity to go through the study that we had on David, I think can think back to some of the history of David. But even today in the nation of Israel, David is a major focus. And why he's a major focus is because he's really the tie to the nation of Israel's claim over that land. And so the more that they can show that King David controlled and ruled and was that historical figure, the more that they can lay claim that this is not something that Israel simply came in and took land from other people, but rather that this land was Israel's thousands of years ago, King David. Well, there's a lot of people that don't want that evidence. There's a lot of people that don't want evidence that King David existed. And there is, in the northern part of the kingdom, there is a mound up in the northern part called a tell, and it's associated with the town of Dan. And Dan was the northern, perceived to be the northernmost area of the population of Israel. And around Dan, they've done a lot of excavating, and they found a fragment of a stone. And on that fragment of the stone, it had a reference to the Davidic kingdom. And it used the phrase House of David. And that was a big deal. When they found that stone, and I think it was back in the I think it was back in the 90s when they found that stone, that was history. That there was a reference to the House of David on an ancient stone buried in the ground somewhere. And if you continue to look, they do not have a lot of evidence about the Davidic kingdom. And one of the reasons they don't have a lot of evidence is because there's parts of Jerusalem that nobody is allowed to excavate. So under the Temple Mount, for instance, you would probably find evidence. You would probably find the foundation of the temples. You would find those things that would show evidence, and absolutely nobody is allowed to excavate under the Temple Mount. So they do excavate under the old city of David, the finger of land that comes down from the Temple Mount, but they have to excavate underneath homes and buildings and everything else there, buried way, way down underneath. And there they find stairs, and there they find fragments of pottery, and there they find all sorts of things, but it's very difficult to excavate and to do the archaeological digs there. But when they entered the city of David in 1967 for that war, they were entering the city of David, and the nation of Israel rallies around their understanding that David was this great king. Now, we've got a lot of this biblical history, of course, in Scripture of David the king, but I'm just referencing some of the archaeology and some of the lack of evidence that is in Israel. But believing history, of course, through Scripture, we understand there was a king by the name of David, and he ruled. And I'm sure over time, as they're allowed to reveal and dig, they will find more of this evidence from thousands of years ago. So as we now take a look at this passage, the question that we have before us is, obviously, as we consider our own life, our last words, those things that we want to make sure that we pass on to generations, or perhaps you're not quite ready to consider passing on to generations, but you're living today, today these would be your words? Can we take what David has learned in his life and understand them as our expression of our faith before God today? That's what we're going to be looking at here in 2 Samuel chapter 23. So let's go back to this. So we understand where David came from. We understand that he was a son of Jesse, many different brothers. We know the account in 1 Samuel 16 where he was chosen. And let's, if you've got your Bible with you, I would encourage you to turn over there and take a look at this passage, because this is the anointing of King David, a word that he uses in 2 Samuel 23, the word anointing. But this is his anointing of King David, and it happens in a very unusual way. So 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul, since I have rejected him from being king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and go. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." And Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' And invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what to do. And you shall anoint for me him whom I declare to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" And he said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. So when he came, he looked on Eliab, one of the sons, and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is before him." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as a man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." And then Jesse made Shammah pass. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen these." Then Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "Well, there remains yet the youngest, but behold, he's keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and get him, for he will not sit down till he comes here." And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. And the Lord said, "Arise, anoint him, for this is he." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. And Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. So he was anointed. You know where that anointing came from? It came from a shepherd and sheep. And what they apparently did was, there were parasites, as today, there were parasites that would go after the sheep. And of course, the sheep's wool is very thick, very difficult to get through. So they would congregate around the head of the sheep. And if they got into the ears, then they could get into the rest of the sheep, burrow into the brain and all of that, and the sheep would die. So they poured oil on top of the sheep's head, and it would basically mat the hair down, make it slick, and the parasites couldn't get in. That's anointing. But it became a symbol of protection, it became a symbol of blessing, it became a symbol of consecration, it became a symbol of being called for a very unique purpose. But originally it came from a shepherd anointing his sheep with oil to protect the sheep from the parasites, from the bugs that would come in. So as we come to this particular passage, we read in the first verse here, "The oracle of David, the son of Jesse, the oracle of the man who was raised on high, the anointed of the God of Jacob, the sweet psalmist of Israel." Verse 1, I would say David is communicating something very clearly, that my life was ordained by God. They think he was probably 10 to 15 years old, somewhere in that range. They don't know his exact age when he was anointed. They know that he took the throne at about age 30. So anywhere between 15 to 20 years, he waited from the time that he was anointed to the time that he actually took the throne, that he fully experienced the results of his anointing, about 15 to 20 years. We know during that period of time that he had several opportunities to take the throne early. We know that he had an opportunity with Saul, and it's referenced as you go through those passages in 1 Samuel 24. He had an opportunity, and he said, "I will not lift my hand against my master, for he is the Lord's anointed." So Saul had been anointed, and he had also been anointed, but he was not going to lift his hand against Saul. He was God's anointed. 1 Samuel 26, it happened again. And he said, "The Lord forbid that I should lay a hand on the Lord's anointed." So he didn't push his way into the kingship even then, even though he had been anointed. 2 Samuel 1, somebody came up and admitted that he was the one who had killed Saul in a battle. And he turns and says to this person, "Your blood be on your own head. Your own mouth testified against you when you said, 'I killed the Lord's anointed.'" So the anointing of Saul was as important to David as his own anointing, and he was not going to take advantage of those opportunities when he had to kill Saul, because his life was ordained by God. He saw himself as anointed at a young age, and his life was then in God's hands, God's timing. He was ordained. His life was ordained by God. So, that's David. I was not pulled out of a field somewhere and anointed. Or was I? Are you anointed? Are we anointed? Are we, as those who have placed their faith in Jesus Christ, considered anointed? Interesting. 2 Corinthians 1:21-22. "Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, set his seal of ownership on us, and put his Spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come." Anointed. So as we read this passage and we say, "The oracle of David, the son of Jesse, the oracle of the man who is raised on high, the anointed of the God of Jacob," can we find ourselves in this passage? Are we anointed? Are we consecrated? Are we set apart? Are we blessed? Are we identified as one who will inherit a kingdom? Yes, we are. We are anointed. Now, David was anointed at age 10, 15, waited until age 30. When were you anointed? Some of you would have been anointed as a child, experienced that salvation experience as a child, anointed. Some of you, it happened during your adult life. It is at that time that you began that process of waiting for your kingdom, waiting for your inheritance in the deposit. The Holy Spirit is given to us as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come after our anointing. We have been anointed. Next, verses 2 through 4. "The Spirit of the Lord speaks by me. His word is on my tongue. The God of Israel has spoken. The rock of Israel has said to me, 'When one rules justly over men, ruling in the fear of God, he dawns on them like the morning light, like the sun shining forth on a cloudless morning, like rain that makes grass to sprout from the earth.'" I think David is saying here, I was simply his servant. Throughout this entire period of time, throughout my entire life, I was simply his servant. What we don't see here, though, is as you read this passage of Scripture, you're not sure exactly what the tone of David's voice is when he reads this. Now let me read it a couple of different ways. "The Spirit of the Lord speaks by me. His word is on my tongue. The God of Israel has spoken. The rock of Israel has said to me. When one rules justly over men, ruling in the fear of God, he dawns on them, me, like the morning light, like the sun shining forth on a cloudless morning, like rain that makes grass to sprout from the earth." See, it really was about me. God spoke to me. So we can't hear from this particular passage what David's tone was when he was speaking this. But there is another passage I want to take you to, and it's also in Samuel, 2 Samuel 7, verses 18 through 29, and I would encourage you to turn over to that passage for a second, because it is a prayer where David says some very similar things, but I think we get a better idea as to what his tone of voice would have been when he would have said these things. It would have not been about him, but it would have been about God. 2 Samuel 7, beginning with verse 18. Then King David went in and sat before the Lord and said, "Who am I, O Lord God, and what is my house that you have brought me thus far? And yet this was a small thing in your eyes, O Lord God. You've spoken also of your servant's house for a great while to come, and this is instruction for mankind, O Lord God. And what more can David say to you? For you know your servant, O Lord God, because of your promise and according to your own heart, you have brought about all this greatness to make your servant know it. Therefore you are great, O Lord God, for there is none like you, and there is no God besides you, according to all that we have heard with our ears. And who is like your people Israel, the one nation on earth whom God went to redeem to be his people, making himself a name for doing for them great and awesome things by driving out before your people, whom you redeemed for yourself from Egypt, a nation and its gods. And you established for yourself your people Israel to be your people forever. And you, O Lord, became their God. And now, O Lord God, confirm forever the word that you have spoken concerning your servant and concerning his house, and do as you have spoken. And your name will be magnified forever, saying, 'The Lord of hosts is God over Israel.' And the house of your servant David will be established before you. For you, O Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, have made this revelation to your servant, saying, 'I will build you a house.' Therefore your servant has found courage to pray this prayer to you. And now, O Lord God, you are God, and your words are true, and you have promised this good thing to your servant. Now therefore may it please you to bless the house of your servant so that it may continue forever before you. For you, O Lord God, have spoken, and with your blessing shall the house of your servant be blessed forever." What's his tone of voice? What's the tone of voice that he's expressing there? It's one of humility, right? It's one of humility.
It is one of bowing before God. So we see in that first verse there, we see an individual who understands that his life was ordained by God, and we see in verses 2 through 4 that he was simply a servant. If you go through this passage of 2 Samuel 7, you will see this progression. First of all, he talks about, "I am your servant." He talks about your sovereignty. He talks about your word. He talks about your will. He talks about your power, your people, your promise, your name, your blessings, your servant. And when he gets down to the very end, when he gets down to the last verse there, verse 29, "Now therefore may it please you to bless the house of your servant so that it may continue forever before you. For you, O Lord God, have spoken, and with your blessing shall the house of your servant be blessed forever." What is the basis for him even asking for that blessing? As you read down through here, why would he even be bold enough to ask? Could have handled it one of two ways, right? He could have gone through the list and he could have said, "I did this and I did this and I did this, now therefore, bless me." But rather, he says, "It is your sovereignty, it is your power. I am simply your servant. Based upon who you are, based upon what you have done, based upon your promises, now I am asking that you would bless me, that you would bless the house of your servant so that it may continue before you forever as you have promised. I say what he has prayed here is reality. What he has prayed here is the reality that we face. It is God's promise. It is God's power. It is God doing. It is God promising. It is all of this. Do we have righteous acts which we can claim credit? And, you know,
John 15, 1 through 5, I am the true vine, my Father is the gardener. No branch can bear fruit by itself, it must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. My life is ordained by God. I am simply your servant. These are the words of David at the end of his life, his perspective. Let's go to the next one. Verse 5. My faith is in the promise keeper. He turns now and says, for does not my house stand so with God? For he has made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and secure, for he will not cause to prosper. For will he not cause to prosper all my help and my desire? On what basis would he be even praying this? Well, we know again from the Davidic covenant that David was offered and provided to, the unilateral covenant that David was provided, it was God's promising him that his kingdom would stand forever. In 2 Samuel 7:11, he says this, moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house when your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers. I will raise up your offspring after you. You shall come, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. And your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. David's confidence, David's faith was based in the promise. One who had made the promise, the one who would keep the promise. Do we have an unconditional promise from God? What would be our unconditional promise from God? We find it in Romans, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 8. Our confidence, as we get a perspective on our life, ordained, a life are being ordained by God, we are simply his servant, our faith is in the promise keeper. And the last passage, verses 6 through 7. But worthless men are like thorns that are thrown away, for they cannot be taken with the hand, but the man who touches them arms himself with iron and the shaft of a spear, and they are utterly consumed with fire. So what's the shaft and the spear? What is he trying to do in explaining the thorns? There is within Israel, and it is a very hot, rocky, there are places where the only thing that's going to grow, unless you work at it very hard, are thorns. When the nation of Israel came back into the land, it was barren, it was desolate. If you've seen pictures of prior to 1944, when the nation of Israel came to be, you would find hot rocks, desert, barren, and filled with weeds and thorns and those things that would naturally grow. Since that time, the nation of Israel has come in, they have planted, they have moved water, they have fertilized, they have done a lot of things to make things grow. But thorns were common throughout the nation of Israel. How do you handle your roses? Usually you're going to put gloves on when there are thorns. Usually you're going to handle locust trees or something like that with gloves on. Here's the picture of somebody who has thorns growing around, and rather than touching them, rather than getting close to them where they can be hurt, they take a shaft and a spear and they cut them off. They gather them up with the shaft and the spear and they burn. And that's the picture that he has here of worthless men, of evil people who have made the decision to reject Christ, to reject the Father, to not have any. Says they are gathered up. And I say David was looking back and he was looking at his perspective, my security comes from God. You can see it in verses 5 and then 6 and 7. It is as though in verse 5 it's more of an offense. He is asking God that he bless, and that in verses 6 through 7, he's asking God that he defend. That the defense of the evil would be his, that the blessing would be his. John chapter 10 gives us a very similar promise. My sheep listen to my voice, I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. See, understand as we take a look at this passage, that what we're seeing is David at the end of his life having this perspective of, my life is ordained by God. I am simply his servant. My faith is in the promise keeper. My security comes from God. What could David have listed at the end of his life? And I'm going to pause here and I'm going to ask for some participation from you. We have seen what David has asked. What could he have said in his last words? You know David's life. You know what he experienced. What could he have said rather than this? So, his accomplishments, right? And I am so proud of what I have done in this life. And David did a lot. There were very few battles that David lost. And he enlarged the land that Saul had, that was left to him, significantly pushed out the boundaries, took it approximately, not quite as far, but approximately to the land that was promised. Look at the accomplishments that I have done. Sheila? Sorry for all the times he's messed up. He probably would have had a list of regrets. I'm really sorry that I did that. I'm really sorry that I did that. What else could he have listed? What else could he have said? Say that again. The building of the temple, regrets that he didn't build the temple, regrets that maybe was something that he would have really have liked to have done, could have reflected on that. What else could he have said? I would like to thank all the little people who have made me great. I want to be sure and thank everyone who has supported me as king. But he didn't, did he? Rather than focusing upon serious sins that he committed, rather than focusing upon his accomplishments, rather than focusing upon those others who have helped him be great, all the great men that are listed in his armies, other passages, he focused on God. He focused on, my life is ordained by God. I am simply his servant. My faith is in the promise keeper. My security comes from God. What gave him that perspective? Why would David have come to the end of his life and had that perspective versus the other list of regrets or accomplishments or whatever else he might have put on his list? Why would he have done that? And I think there's a very simple answer to it. He knew God. He knew God. He knew who God was. He knew that it wasn't him. He knew that it wasn't his greatness. He knew that it wasn't all of his accomplishments. And he understood this clearly, that while sins were part of his life, that was not the focus either. It was God. God was the focus of David's life. And that was the end of his life. That was his perspective of his entire life, that it wasn't me. it was all God. It was all God. And so he didn't have to go through the regrets. He didn't have to go through the accomplishments, the list of greatness of himself. He simply identified, my life from the very beginning was an anointing. I was chosen. That I am simply his servant. That my faith is in the promise of you. My security comes from God. So as we look at our own lives, and we're all at various stages, age-wise, in our spiritual life as well, how old we are spiritually, all of these things. The acceptance of reality that this is true, that this is, we are simply his servant, that we are to place our faith only in the promise keeper, not in ourselves, that our security does come from God, is a learning experience that we're all in right now. To coming to this conclusion at any point in our life and as we grow in our faith, to coming to this conclusion. A couple of things as I was thinking about this passage was, I hope it's not the end of my life when I have come to this conclusion. I hope that as I continue to grow, my conviction of these truths deepen. And it's not a matter of waiting till the end and looking back and saying, aha. And so I would say to those of you that aren't at the end of life, that perspective is available today. It's true. But there was something else that struck me as I was even thinking about our group here. And that is that no matter where we are in this life, and I'm not speaking necessarily of age, but no matter where we are in this life, this is a common denominator for all of us. That we may come from very different backgrounds and be in very different places in this life and have different responsibilities and whatever it might be, but all of this is true regardless. And so you look at a great man like David, and he is probably identified as the pinnacle of the kingdom of Israel. And if people are praying at the Wailing Wall today, they are praying for a return of the kingdom of David. They want to go back to the time of David. He is that great. To this great man, that we may not be King David, we may not be David, but our perspective of that we are anointed and that we are simply his servant and that our faith is in the promise keeper and our security comes from God is how we can live today. Today. I want to say one other thing, because some of this as I was moving through these passages, these applications to my own life. What happens when I don't live like this? What happens when one of these things fall out in my own understanding of my life? When I don't understand that I am simply his servant and that the full responsibility for my Christian life and everything that happens in the world around me is my responsibility. What happens when my faith is not in the promise keeper, but in me, living the righteous life? When it is up to me to live that righteous life and to make sure that I stay secure by living that righteous life? What happens when I forget who I am and that I am not anointed, that I am not one of his, that I am on my own out here and there is nothing special about me? The understanding, the accepting of the reality of what David has shown us in his last words, the accepting of that reality has profound implications on how I live and how I cope with stress. When I suddenly believe that I'm much more than a servant, that it's me and God partnering together can get a lot done, versus I am simply his servant. I am simply the one that is going to take his direction. That I will speak what God wants me to speak, that I will do only what God wants me to do, that it's not me to initiate, but it's me to respond to my master, I will live very differently. I will live at peace when I am simply his servant. I will live at peace in knowing that my security of my salvation comes from God and not from me accomplishing and being righteous, but it is His righteousness. So as we look at this passage of Scripture and we see that David has come to these conclusions, the faster we come to these conclusions ourselves, the faster that we come to an understanding of who God is and how we can live as a result of these truths, the faster it is that we live in peace, the faster it is that we find joy in our salvation, that we find productivity as we do what He wants us to do because He's in it. It works. It is a prescription for success in life that David has provided to us through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So maybe you identify with one of those four and you say, wow, I'm really struggling with that one. I mean, I don't see myself as special. As a matter of fact, what I see in myself is I see myself in sin. I see myself living not as God wants me to live. And He says I'm anointed. He says that I'm chosen. He says that I'm special. He says that I have an inheritance yet to come, but I don't see myself that way. Or maybe you struggle with I'm simply His servant. Maybe it's a matter of pride. Maybe it's a matter of over-responsibility. Maybe it's a matter of not understanding our own weaknesses and how God sees us as dust. Maybe it's understanding that. Or faith in the promise keeper. Maybe we've had struggles with faith in others. Maybe we've had struggles with trust in our life. We find ourselves now struggling with trust in Him. Or security. Insecurity. I live a life of insecurity. The security comes from God. So the question of how did David come to these conclusions and why didn't he say something different, I think is a very simple answer, as I said earlier. And that is that he knew God. He knew who God was. And as we learn and as we understand who God is and who Christ is, we come to these conclusions. We come to an acceptance that this is reality. That this isn't us inventing something, but it is simply understanding that this is true. That this is who we are. David says, this is who I am. We say the same. We see in the New Testament passages those parallel promises that he had the Old Testament specific to him. And it's amazing. We can pray this prayer today. We can have these be our last words at the end of our life. We can have these be our testimony today. My life is ordained by God. I am simply His servant. My faith is in the promise keeper. My security comes from God. We can rest. Father God, we can put these words up on the screen. Read them, but we understand that they are profound. That they are profound because we struggle with these four concepts throughout our entire life. We focus on the wrong things. We focus on us. We focus on our inadequacies. We focus on our insecurities. And we wonder sometimes why we're struggling so hard. Know that our focus needs to be on you. That our focus needs to be on what you have done and who you are. And that we will find in that truth, we will find in that reality that has dramatic impact on how we live today. But Father, we know that it is a mystery. It is an understanding that is not natural. It is an understanding that only you can give to us. It is a seeking of you and you revealing yourself to us. Father, we live this life and sometimes we have it absolutely reversed. We focus on ourselves and then we turn to you, and we know that as we focus on you, we will gain perspective on ourselves and on our life. Father, keep that in our minds. Keep that in our lives, that our focus would be on you on a daily basis, that we might find our proper position before you as your servant, as the one that you have anointed, as as the promise keeper and as the one who provides us all the security that we need in this life. We ask this in